all our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry a solace there. Joyful, joyful, we adore you, God of glory, Lord of love. Hearts unfold like flowers before you, opening to the sun above. Melt the clouds of sin and sadness, drive the dark of doubt away. Giver of immortal gladness, fill us with the light of day.
Father, there is no shadow of turning. Good morning. Welcome as we gather together in God's house to worship Him. Today we continue our look at the book of Romans. Today we want to get along. We want to love our neighbor as ourselves, and we understand the challenges that provides for us in our day-to-day relationships. We understand the problems that have been occurring within our world with loving our neighbor as ourselves, but with God's help, we can and should show the mark of Christians and be leaders when it comes to loving our neighbor and showing the way that we should live with each other. Today we have Wendy Sue Fliggy with us to help us with our music. Wendy Sue has had the unique ministry of taking her music on the road, singing in 31 states in the U.S. and on the Caribbean cruise February 2019. She has partnered with hundreds of churches and organizations for worship services, concerts, and women's retreats. This is actually her full-time job. She sings on a weekly live series on Facebook called Bold Life. Her CDs, Everyday Christian and Bold, are available for you this morning and contain a mix of original songs, hymns, and praise songs, many of which we'll be singing together. You can buy one for yourself, of course, buy one for a friend. And stream her music on the variety of resources that are out there, Spotify, iTunes, Apple, and other, and see her faith-based videos on YouTube. When she's not traveling, she teaches private music lessons in her home studio, Menominee Falls, Wisconsin, where she lives with Craig, who is serving as the music guru today, making sure all the sound goes as planned for 24 years. And they have two fabulous young adults, Colin, 19, Miranda, 21. So we're glad to have Wendy Sue with us today, as we've all experienced within the church, getting back into what we know church to be, the divine service, God to us, and our responding in worship, just all of us coming together. It's been difficult for Wendy Sue and other musicians to even find a place where they can share their gifts with the Lord. So we're glad she's able to be with us today, and Jacob was able to make this opportunity possible for us. So within our bulletins today, she has all the music in there for us to sing with her. Remember, singing with her, like we do with the TAPS service. And so we continue with the song, Mighty to Save. May God bless our worship together.
A blessing to be here in God's house with you all. Let's raise our voices together.
Everyone needs compassion, a love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior. The hope of nations.
All right, we're going to sing this out now.
Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Offer us salvation.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
And let us pray. Almighty God, your Son willingly endured the evil of sin and death at the cross for our redemption. Grant to us the goodness of our Savior, so that we are not overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
So this next song is taken from Psalm 103, and we're going to break it up into parts, as you can see. Pastor will lead us through a confession time, and we'll also speak some of the words directly from that psalm in between the verses and choruses. So you'll hear the music playing throughout, underneath while we're speaking as well. We bless the Lord for all his goodness to us.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I'll worship your holy name. The sun comes up.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, all my inmost being.
Praise his holy name.
Bless the Lord, O my soul.
And forgive him out of all his debts.
He forgives all your sins and heals all your diseases.
He redeems our life from the pit and crowns us with love and compassion.
He satisfies your desires with good things, so that your youth is renewed like the eagles.
The Lord works righteousness and justice.
He made known his ways to Moses, his deeds to the people of Israel.
The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in love.
He will not always curse, nor will he harbor his anger forever. He does not treat us as our sins deserve, nor repay us according to our iniquities.
As high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love.
Have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us.
But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
us therefore come before his throne of grace with humble and sincere hearts to lay our burdens down. Gracious Lord, we come before you, laying the burden of our sin at the foot of your cross. We openly acknowledge our failure to follow your plans for our lives. We have stumbled and fallen in our service to you. We have placed our agenda ahead of yours. We have been shallow in our love toward you and toward those you have placed in our path. We cry out for mercy, trusting in your promise to forgive us through the love of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. God has heard your cry for mercy and fulfills his promise to save and deliver you. Lavishing his grace upon you in Jesus, he enables you to love and forgive as he has first loved and forgiven you. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Now for the reading is from God's Word. Our Old Testament reading is from Jeremiah chapter 15. O Lord, you know, remember me and visit me, and take vengeance for me on my persecutors. In your forbearance, take me not away. Know that for your sake I bear reproach. Your words were found, and I ate them, and your words became to me a joy and the delight of my heart. For I am called by your name, O Lord, God of hosts. I did not sit in the company of revelers, nor did I rejoice. I sat alone because your hand was upon me. You had filled me with indignation. Why is my pain unceasing, my wound incurable, refusing to be healed? Will you be to me like a deceitful brook, like waters that fail? Therefore, thus says the Lord, if you return, I will restore you, and you shall stand before me. If you utter what is precious and not what is worthless, you shall be as my mouth. They shall turn to you, but you shall not turn to them. And I will make to you this people a fortified wall of bronze, and they will fight against you, but they shall not prevail over you. For I am with you to save you and deliver you, declares the Lord. I will deliver you out of the hand of the wicked and redeem you from the grasp of the ruthless. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our epistle is from Romans chapter 12. Let love be genuine. Abhor what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with brotherly affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not be slothful in zeal. Be fervent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in tribulation. Be constant in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints and seek to show hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Never be conceited. Repay no one evil for evil, but give thought to do what is honorable in the sight of all. If possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave it to the wrath of God, for it is written, "Vengeance is mine. I will repay," says the Lord. To the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. For by so doing, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. This is the word of the Lord. And let us rise. Hallelujah. Whoever would save his life will lose it.
But whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. Hallelujah.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 16th chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
From that time, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed, and on the third day be raised. Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, "Far be it from you, Lord, this shall never happen to you." But he turned and said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan. You are a hindrance to me. You are not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of man." Then Jesus told his disciples, "If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. Whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and forfeits his life? Or what shall a man give in return for his life? For the Son of Man is going to come with the angels in the glory of his Father, and then he will repay each person according to what he has done. Truly I say to you, there are some standing here who will not taste death until they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
We join together to make confession of our Christian faith this morning. We use the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated now as we sing the next song, "Take My Life and Let It Be."
These words will be familiar to you, but the melody is slightly different. I'm sure you'll catch on. It sounds like this. Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. Take my moments and my days, let them flow in the ceaseless praise. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of thank you.
grace, mercy, and peace be yours, God, our Heavenly Father, and from our risen and living Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, as we continue our study of the book of Romans, a particular timely passage with all that's going on in our world today and what goes on in our everyday lives as we live with one another, friends and enemies, our neighbors. And so our focus are these words from Paul. Let love be genuine. Abhor what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with brotherly affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not be slothful in zeal. Be fervent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in tribulation. Be constant in prayer. Can't we all just get along? I mean, really? Can't we all just get along? Can't we just love our neighbor as ourselves? Can't we see everyone around us as our neighbor and treat them as we want to be treated? This is a part of our everyday life, isn't it? We aren't created to live in isolation. We don't live on our own personal island, away from other people. We live together. Just as we witness here at church this morning, look around you. There are other people present here. People who I hope are your friends and not your enemies. But whether they are your friend or your enemy, they are certainly your neighbor. And you and I are to love one another as we have been loved. So how can we show love to our neighbor? What does this look like? What are the rules that are involved? Well, Susie learned this from a very early age in her own home. You see, her parents said to Susie, there are rules that govern this house. Rules that govern our relationship with one another. And these are the rules. You will speak this way. You will act this way. By doing so, there is peace and harmony in our home. Everything is the way that it should be and it needs to be. However, Susie, if you choose or we choose not to live according to these rules and laws, there are consequences. In other words, there's going to be tension in this house. There's going to be judgment in this house, punishment that occurs for not following these rules and laws. So Susie understood what her parents were saying and wanted peace and harmony, just as her parents wanted peace and harmony, so they efforted the best that they could to keep these rules and laws. But there were times when they didn't, both her parents and Susie, and the tension existed and judgment occurred to correct that behavior and to get everyone on the same path, loving one another. Now, within her household, fortunately, they never became enemies, but there certainly was tension from time to time. As Susie continued on her life's journey from the house, she went to school, and guess what? When she went to school, there were rules and laws that she encountered there. Not much different than what she had in her house. This is the way that you are to act. This is the way that you are to speak. If you don't do these things, you're going to end up in the principal's office. There's going to be tension in the classroom. There will be a price to pay. to correct your behavior, to let you know what's right and what's wrong so that we can live in harmony within this school. But what Susie began to realize, unlike her home where becoming an enemy really wasn't an option, even though there was tension that existed, things were able to be worked out. That's not the same when it came to her time at school. Even though she tried to be good, she failed, and those around her who tried to be good failed, and sometimes enemies then would exist, and this tension would take place, and she would have to then intermingle with these classmates from time to time. We can all relate to this, can't we? From the home to school and even into the workplace, there are rules, there's laws that are established to show us how we should love one another, to keep harmony with each other. Boss says, this is how I want this place to run. This is what I expect from you and each and every employee, so that we can be efficient, we can make this a happy place in which to be. If you choose not to follow this, though, we're going to have tension, we're going to have problems, we're not going to be productive, and you're going to get fired. Ultimately, that's what's going to occur. We just can't get along. And you know in your workplaces, the effort to be good. Hopefully, your fellow employees effort to be good. But it doesn't always happen. And even in the workplace, we should have friends. Sometimes there are enemies. Again, everyone's still our neighbor, which is important to remember in the midst of it all. But there can be times in which we just struggle with getting along. This is not just Susie's experience from her house and going to school and to work, as you and I all have experienced. But she also had another set of rules which were more important than all of the others that really served as a basis for the rules and laws that she was observing in these other places. And it was that she was a Christian. And as a Christian, as a child of God, she knew that she was to follow God's word and what God said on how to conduct her life. She was taught the Ten Commandments. She learned them. She was taught to practice them. We all know what they are, that we should honor those who have authority over us, that we should not kill, we should not commit adultery, we should not steal, we should not bear false witness against our neighbor, we should not covet. If you can do these things, you can live in harmony and peace with one another. And we can all agree with that. We all understand that to do these things is good, is neighborly. We're loving God and therefore loving our neighbor as ourselves. It doesn't get any better than that. So why is it that we just can't get along? Why is it that we fail to be good neighbors? Christian neighbors. It's because we are all sinners. It's because we have enemies that exist within our lives, our sinful nature and our sinful world and the devil, which manipulates all of these things so that our eyes, our lives are no longer focused upon God's word, but are focused inward, focused on what we think is best and how we think we should approach the relationship with others. And when our sinful nature, when our sinful world, when the devil is manipulating our lives in such a way that it is determining how we are to live with one another, it is never good. Never good. We transgress, they transgress. Tension, anger, hostility. It's hard to see anyone as a neighbor when sin prevails in our lives. Some would say that to live as a neighbor with one another is then utterly hopeless. Because of who we are, because of the way the world is. But it's not hopeless. God has come to us, and God is with us. Think about who we were before God. Before God, without Jesus, we are dead in our sins. We are hopeless and lost. We only know eternal death. We are not God's friends. We are his enemies because of sin. And yet God, in his mercy and loving kindness, sought to save us. Sought to deliver us from sin and death, to restore that which was lost because of sin. To take away our hopelessness that comes from sin and death, and to give us hope, to unite us back to himself. And that's what God has accomplished through his Son, Jesus. Jesus suffered and died on the cross. He bore our sins in his flesh so that we can receive forgiveness, pardon, peace. And that's exactly what we have received. We are no longer God's enemies. We are no longer hopeless. We have been united with him because Jesus, who died on the cross, paid the price for our sin, as his resurrection declares, and all who believe in him are forgiven and have eternal life. And because God has forgiven us in Jesus, we who are undeserving, we now in turn, through God's help and through his word, by the power of the Holy Spirit, live in this forgiveness toward one another. Live with mercy toward one another. Live with striving for peace and joy and unity. That's what happens when we forgive one another, because that's what happened when God forgave us. It's not easy to do. Because we're so fast-paced, and we're so immediate with our decisions and with our actions, that we don't take time to weigh the consequences of what we are doing and what we are saying before all of this takes place, and then that tension and sorrow exists, that separation occurs. That's why we always have the cross, by which we receive forgiveness when we have failed, that we can forgive others who have failed as well. Paul gives us three wonderful ways in order to try to be neighborly each and every day. Three wonderful ways or practices that we should put forth in our lives to show these marks of being a Christian. And the first one, Paul says, is we should rejoice in hope. Are we people of hope? I sure hope we are people of hope. We are people who are redeemed. We are people who know where our eternity will be with the Lord forever. Think about living in this hope, rejoicing in hope every day. What a change it should make every day we get up. It doesn't even matter whether it's a Monday or not. Even on a Monday, we can get out of bed. Well, we may not feel like it. It may be difficult. It may be hard. But when we know the hope that is ours in Jesus, our disposition, our attitude should change. And with the change of disposition and attitude, and to go in the day with this type of hope, can and will make a difference in our relationship to others. We all know what it's like. If I don't have my cup of coffee, stand back. But if I have my heart filled with Jesus and the hope that is mine in him, Then I'm going to look at my neighbor, those around me, as those with whom Christ died and rose, those with whom I want to be in heaven with me, and therefore, when it comes to my relationship with them, guided by God's word, my living and my attitude will change. I'll approach each day as a new day, as a day that the Lord has made. And I'm going to rejoice, and I'm going to be glad in it. The second wonderful tool that Paul gives to us in terms of being neighborly to one another, rejoicing in hope, being patient in tribulation. Patience when dealing with one another. How important that is. After all, it is a gift of the Holy Spirit. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, and self-control. God gives us patience. He is there to strengthen our patience. How necessary that is. When we go into work and we see something not quite right, or we go into our homes and we see something not right, or we hear something not quite right, we want to just lose it. We want to just take action immediately, say something immediately. And we should all be wise enough to know that usually doesn't work. We say something that we shouldn't have said. We've done something that we shouldn't have done. We think we were in the right, but as we look back on it, man, did we just make the situation a lot worse. And what we could have done in the midst of what we see is wrong, or dealing with our enemy and dealing with the frustration right in front of us, if we just would have been patient, if we just would have stepped back for a moment. You know what your parents taught you? Count to 100? You count to 1,000? Whatever it takes so that you don't sin, that you don't cross over from light to darkness, but can approach that situation the way it needs to be done, so as to gain a neighbor or to remain neighbors. Not to add to the fire or start a fire. It's all happened to us. We've seen it happen within our world. People are so quick to tweet. They're so quick to text. They're so quick to email. They're so quick to call. They're so quick to write a letter. And they hit send. And they put that stamp on the envelope. And it's gone. Goes into the hands of someone, in the eyes of someone, and the next thing you know, man, do I feel terrible. It's important that we, and this is not the greatest expression of all when it comes to dealing with our neighbor and being patient, to kill one another with kindness. Step back. Compliment the other person. Find a way out. Switch the subject, whatever it takes, so as to get along. Communicate. How about that? One-on-one, in a calm fashion, in a place, in a time when things can be done correctly. None of this is rocket science, is it? I don't think any of us are rocket scientists out here. I haven't heard that from any of our membership. It's not rocket science. But something we all know, and something that God leads us to be able to do and to live within our lives. Finally, Paul says to be constant in prayer. Constant in prayer. With the Lord, begin your task. With the Lord, begin your task. Lord, I know I'm going to encounter other people today. I'd rather be on an island and not see anyone for any length of time, but I know that's not possible. So help me, guide me, lead me today and every day. Remind me of the hope that is mine in Jesus. Remind me that I have joy in my heart that I am forgiven of my sins. Remind me of all of these things so I can go into my day loving one another, being kind and compassionate to one another. And not only when you get up, but throughout the day, when you go to bed, prayer is so important, so valuable. Lord, I commend my life into your hands. My thoughts and my words and my deeds. May all that I do be acceptable in your sight. And if I fail, forgive me and help me to forgive my neighbor. We are all in this together. Make no mistake about it, we're all in this together. You might have noticed within our epistle reading that the words that we send to you when a member of our church dies are found right here in our text. When a member of our church dies, you get an email. The entire congregation, rejoice with those who rejoice and weep with those who weep. The reason we do this is not because you know the person personally. You may not. They may go to Thursday night or 8 o'clock or 10:30, or you may not even have a clue that they were a member, but they're still your neighbor. And we are always to look to others before ourselves so that we can rejoice with those who rejoice, weep with those who weep, be neighborly in all matters of our lives. Can we all just get along? We can. And we should, because God leads and directs our lives. And this is the marks of being a Christian: to rejoice in hope, to be patient in tribulation, to be constant in prayer. Amen. And now may the love of God, which far surpasses our understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus until he does return in glory. Amen. Again today, our offering is received as you came in today. You can also give through our online giving program. We're very thankful for the blessings that God has given to us even during this time, and the ability we even have to have Wendy Sue here today. And so we have our offertory song.
A beautiful way to love our neighbors is to share the message of hope with them by our words as well as our actions. Listen for two stories in this song. It's my original song. The first story is my testimony, and the second story is a neighbor who was witnessed to by another neighbor and thus came to know Jesus. Maybe there's still someone waiting to hear the message of Jesus from you.
Life was full of Christians in a loving, cozy home. And as she grew, she always knew that she was saved by Christ alone. Church each Sunday morning, nightly bedtime prayers. Her mom and dad, good at that, teaching her how Jesus cares. And through the years she'd read, and through the years she'd pray. And now she goes through life. Thank you.
Disciples of Jesus Christ, both here at Good Shepherd, including those and members in the spotlight, the Pipcorn, Shavy, and Suhita families, and throughout the world. That we not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Let us pray to the Lord.
Bless us, Jesus, as we follow you.
For the fulfillment of the Great Commission, especially today, as we lift up Reverend Ron Krieger, installed at Bethany Lutheran. That wherever the good news of salvation in Christ is proclaimed, hearts turn to the Lord and live. Let us pray to the Lord.
Bless us, Jesus, as we follow you.
For all servants and leaders in the church, including our President Matthew Harrison, our District President Dwayne Lewick, and our Circuit Visitor Reverend Jeff Smiles, and in the world, that their work for our blessing show forth the goodness of Christ to the world he died to save. Let us pray to the Lord.
Bless us, Jesus, as we follow you.
For the blessing of all who hunger and thirst, for all who are weary and heavy laden, and for all who are without house or income, that they seek the restoration the Lord's good hand provides. Let us pray to the Lord.
Bless us, Jesus, as we follow you.
For all who willingly put themselves in the path of evil for the sake of others' good, including military members, law enforcement officers, and emergency workers, that they be protected by the Lord's mighty hand. Let us pray to the Lord.
Bless us, Jesus, as we follow you.
For all who ail in heart, mind, and body, especially for Wayne Schwab, Brian Medicoven, and Edward Flynn, that they be touched by the healing hand of our Savior and filled with the presence of his comforting spirit. Let us pray to the Lord.
Bless us,
for those affected by recent weather challenges, especially those suffering from Hurricane Laura, dear Lord, provide the help and support for their immediate and long-term needs. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, we thank you for the gifts of time, talent, and treasure that you bless us with, and we thank you for sharing Wendy Sue with us today. May our ministry of the gospel continue to grow and prosper, that all may hear of your salvation. And bless our congregation as we give of our time, talent, and treasure for the good of your kingdom and for the growth of your kingdom. Let us pray to the Lord.
Bless us, Jesus.
Lord, in the midst of challenges and evil, sometimes we forget your many blessings. So we are happy to celebrate with Ed and Carol Kettner as they celebrate their 63rd wedding anniversary. May their love for you and for each other continue to deepen and grow with each passing day. Let us pray to the Lord.
Bless us, Jesus, as we follow you.
And into your hands, O Lord, we lift up all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, that your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, confident that you hear us for his sake alone. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks.
Blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth. You have had mercy on those whom you created and sent your only begotten Son into our world to trounce evil and its deception by his death upon the cross. With joyful hearts, we receive the victory over death and the grave which he secured for us by rising from the tomb. Gathered in the name and the remembrance of Jesus, we ask you, O Lord, to forgive, renew, and strengthen us with your word and spirit. Give us faith to receive your Son, Jesus Christ, to take up our cross daily, and to overcome the evil of our world with the goodness of the one who died for us all. With gratitude in our hearts, we praise you, O Father and Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, in the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." After the same manner also he took the cup after supper. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." As often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Amen. Come, Lord Jesus.
O Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
You may be seated.
Jesus shed his blood.
Strengthen and preserve in you the true faith until life everlasting. We live with God's forgiveness, joy, and peace. Amen. And let us pray. Gracious God, our Heavenly Father, you have given us a foretaste of the feast to come in the Holy Supper of your Son's body and blood. Keep us firm in the true faith throughout our days of pilgrimage, that on the day of his coming we may together with all your saints celebrate the marriage feast of the Lamb in his kingdom, which has no end. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
For our announcements, a lot is going to take place in a very short period of time. This coming Wednesday, we begin confirmation for second and third year students. On the 6th, we begin Sunday school for all ages. Although adult Sunday school has been meeting, you can join me in the community room following the service as we look at our gospel lesson today and Peter's rebuke of Jesus, and Jesus' rebuke of then Peter, and talking about taking up our cross and following Jesus. Also, then on the 13th, confirmation will be held at both services with our 21 confirmands, and there will be plenty of room for everyone. We'll have 15 empty pews, plus the balcony and community room. So we want you to be a part of the confirmation service, confirmation celebration. They've been waiting a long time for this, an opportunity for all of us to bear witness to their faith and to reaffirm our faith in our great God. We also thank Wendy Sue for being with us today. Again, in the balcony is how we're doing music right now for the time being. She will be available to talk to you She has a table that's in the hallway. We know it can be a little congested in there, but there is some items there if you want to take a look at. But we'll encourage her to be out also with me outside to be able to talk with everyone after this service. And now we go forth with the blessing of the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with his favor. Grant you his everlasting peace.
Amen. This closing song is another one of my original songs. It really fits today with the whole idea of using our lives to God's glory. So we have him take every aspect of our lives and make it more like him. It's very energetic and joy-filled, and you're welcome to put your hands together and clap in worship this morning as well, if you so desire. It starts off with the chorus, and then we'll jump in together and sing it.
Take every aspect of my life. Take every aspect, Jesus Christ. Take every aspect in all I do. Make every aspect more like you. Make me more like you.
All right, that's the chorus. We're going to sing it one more time together.
Take every aspect of my life. Take every aspect, Jesus Christ. Take every aspect in all I do. Make every aspect more like you. Make me more like you. When I look in the mirror, I see a sinner staring back at me. I see my failures and my past mistakes. Lord, I'm needing you to take every aspect of my life. Take every aspect, Jesus Christ. Take every aspect, all I do. Take every aspect, more like you. Make me more like you. Lord, won't you take me, my talents, treasures, time, and use them daily to let your glory shine. I'll be seeing after you are through, that I'll be living a life that's all brand new. Take every aspect of my life. Take every aspect, Jesus Christ. Take every aspect of all I do. Of my life, take every aspect, Jesus Christ.